widely considered to be the most reliable diesel engine of its time. Today, we're talking about an absolute legend. We're talking about common problems and reliability with Dodge's 5.9 Cummins 12-valve, widely considered to be the most reliable diesel engine of its time, especially in today's standards, since the 5.9 Cummins 12-valve had zero emissions equipment, it was mechanically driven, it had very few electronic components, and it was built extremely simplistically and very strongly. The block, the internals, the head, all of the major engine components are absolutely bulletproof. And these engines can last just about as long as you could potentially drive them. The engines certainly outlast every other part of the vehicle that these engines were featured in. It's an exciting engine to talk about because there's a lot of history here. And there's a lot of praise that this engine's gotten over the years because of its reliability and also because of its ability to produce additional power extremely easily. So we'll go ahead and touch on that briefly, but the main focus here is talking about reliability and common problems. While this is, like I said, the most reliable diesel engine ever produced, we still have a couple things that we want to address and some things for you to take into consideration if you're potentially considering buying one of these now, especially that they are 25 plus years old. So despite its widely known reliability, we're gonna go ahead and cover a couple of the basics here that are good to know. Before we jump into some of the problems that the 5.9 Cummins 12 valve has, we'll go ahead and give you a little bit of background on the engine itself. It was first released in 1989, and it lasted all the way through 1998, and about halfway through when it was replaced by the 5.9 Cummins 24 valve. There were a number of changes over the years, most notably in 1991, they added an air-to-air intercooler, and then the biggest one is in 1994, they switched from the VE44 rotary injection pump to the P7100 P-pump fuel injection system. And that's an important change from both a reliability as well as from a performance potential standpoint. So we'll go ahead and touch on that a little bit later. And then in addition to that change, they also used a couple different turbochargers throughout the years. There were three different whole set turbochargers that were used. So now when we look at the 5.9 Cummins, most of the people kind of split the 12 valve into two categories. You have the 1989 until 1993 that used the VE44, and then you have the 94 all the way until 98 and a half that used the P7100. So with those basics out of the way, let's go ahead and jump into the list of common problems here. And most of you could probably guess what the first one on the list is. It is the killer dowel pin. The only serious problem that the 5.9 Cummins 12 valve has at all is with the killer dowel pin. All of the other problems the engine suffers are relatively minor, easy to fix, and don't cause any problems with reliability. But the dowel pin is the one thing that can kill a 5.9 Cummins, hence the name killer dowel pin. So the engine uses a dowel pin that's located in the front timing gear case. And basically this pin is prone to becoming loose and falling out of its hole. Now, if you look at where it's located, the pin is located right in front of the timing gears. And so when the pin falls out, it falls right in between two gears. Ultimately, 95% of the time when this happens, it ends up taking out the whole engine. There is a small chance that the pin can fall all the way through and end up in the oil pan. But the majority of the time, the pin's gonna contact the gears. It's gonna end up throwing timing off. The pistons and the valves are all going to collide together, causing damage to the head, to the block, to the internals. In some cases, that dowel pin can actually get completely ejected outside of the front timing case. When that happens, you'll have a massive oil leak, which will then lead to oil starvation and cause all of the internal components, the head and the block, to all get jacked up as well. 95% of the time, this leads to catastrophic engine failure and you needing a brand new engine or a complete rebuild. While this is a scary problem, I would venture a guess that just about any 12 valve out there on the road today has already had this issue fixed and addressed. You can get a dowel pin kit that essentially bolts the dowel pin into place so that it does not have any potential chance of falling out of its hole. And that kit costs about $50. It's 1000% worth it. That's one of the most important things to check if you are looking at an older 12 valve, just because when this does happen, it leads to serious problems. There are some debate over how common of a problem it is, but it's $50. I don't care how common it is. Just go ahead and fix it. It makes so much more sense than risking potential damage to the engine. The second most common problem is heater grid failure. Unlike the Power Stroke and Duramax engines that use glow plugs, Cummins engines instead use a heater grid. Now that heater grid sits within the intake manifold, and what happens is as air passes through the intake manifold to go down into the cylinders, it passes over the heater grid, which heats up the air and helps the combustion process take place to start the engine and keep the engine running when it's cold. Now the heater grid only kicks on in temperatures below 59 degrees Fahrenheit, so you typically won't notice any problems unless it's in colder weather, but in colder weather you'll have hard starts, the car might die while it's idling right after it turns on, and overall you'll just have a hard problem getting the car started. The heater grid costs about $400 to replace, so it's not a cheap part, but at the same time, it really only affects the starting of the engine in colder temperatures, and it's not something that leads to any other serious problems with the engine, so we'll classify this as minor on our list. The third thing is with the throttle position sensor. The TPS sensor fails pretty frequently, which results in a number of performance issues, rough idling, sluggish acceleration, and so on. These sensors are easy to replace. The OEM sensor is like $200 and something, but you can get aftermarket ones for less than $100. This is a problem. The sensor fails a lot, but it's not that serious of a problem. By any means, just replace the sensor and you're good to go. Moving on to the fourth problem. This problem is specific to 1994 and on vehicles because it has to do with the P7100 injection pump. The P7100 has an overflow valve. The overflow valve basically is a little spring, and what can happen is the spring can break or can weaken over time. The valve seat on it can erode and the valve itself can start leaking. When either of these problems happens with the overflow valve on the P7100, you're going to get reduced fuel pressure and decreased performance because of that. Now you can replace the overflow valve and upgrade it to an adjustable overflow valve for about $50. This problem is not very serious at all. It's very easy to fix and it typically doesn't cause any other issues with the P7100, which by the way, part of the reason that the 1994 through 1998 vehicles are more desirable is because of the P7100 P-pump rather than the VE44. The P7100 can handle 600 wheel horsepower without needing any upgrades because it's a mechanical pump instead of an electronic pump like the newer vehicles are. This P-pump is extremely reliable, can handle a ton of power, which makes it extremely desirable and also makes the newer versions with this P-pump more desirable because they can more easily produce serious power levels. And that sort of takes us into the last problem here that's not as much of a problem, but more so a limitation, and that's with the transmission. As I mentioned, these engines are extremely easy to modify. You can do some at-home, in-your-garage mods for $0 and add over 100 horsepower to these engines. There's a number of simplistic things that you can do, which we have a guide on our Diesel IQ website. You can very easily add power without having to spend a single dollar on modifications, so it is very easy to push up against the transmission horsepower limits. So there are three transmissions in these cars. You have your four-speed automatic, which is the 47RH. That is the least desirable transmission. It will need a torque converter or an upgraded clutch just to handle 300 wheel horsepower. So if you're doing these at home in your garage mods, you're already need to look into upgrading the transmission because the automatic one just can't hold that much power, which is normal for automatic transmissions, and especially ones that were built in the 90s. Now, there were two different manual transmissions, the G360 and the NV4500. The NV4500 was used from 96 until 98, and those ones are the most desirable ones because they can handle about 500 wheel horsepower with just a clutch upgrade. And they can handle a decent bit more than that as well. If you have the NV4500, you don't really need to look at building out your transmission or upgrading it beyond the clutch, so long as you plan on keeping the 5.9 Cummins within a reasonable horsepower level. Now, the G360 can handle a little over 400 wheel horsepower with an upgraded clutch, but to push it much past those levels, you're gonna need to look into getting a built transmission, which adds probably $5,000 of costs onto further modifying the 5.9 Cummins 12 valve. So not a problem, just something to be aware of because it is so tempting to go ahead and do all of those easy at-home mods and toss a bunch of extra power onto your 12 valve. But considering these cars are old, the transmissions are old, you're likely going to run into some problems with them, so you need to factor in transmission upgrades if you're looking into modifications. Anyways, that covers it with our problems on these engines. Really, the only potential thing that can kill these is the dowel pin, but it's $50 to fix it. Most of them are probably fixed now. These engines, with that fixed, are just absolutely bulletproof. All of the other problems that you run into are extremely minor. Because we have mechanical injection pumps, you really don't run into any fuel injection problems like you do on the later 24 valves, which end up resulting in expensive repairs because electronic injection pumps are expensive, fuel injectors are expensive, and all of that. The simplicity of this engine makes them extremely reliable, extremely easy to work on, and limits the number of problems that it has, which ultimately makes them very cost effective to own. There's not too many problems engine related that you can run into on the 12 valve that are gonna lead to expensive repairs. All of this put together really shows you why these are the most reliable diesel engines out there. There are so many examples of these things making it to 500,000 plus miles while also pushing 500 wheel horsepower. You can get these things up to 500 wheel horsepower, which granted is going to take some modifications. You're going to have to build your transmission unless you have the NV4500, but you can get them to those power levels and drive without sacrificing reliability. You can take these engines, get them up a little bit closer to modern diesel power standards, and not have to worry about any of the problems that you run into with the newer diesel engines because these are simple engines, there's zero emissions equipment, everything's mechanical, and so on. At the end of the day, we couldn't say anything more highly on the Cummins 12 valve, and that is coming from myself, who owns a 7.3 Power Stroke, which everyone likes to say is the second most reliable diesel engine. Even coming from a Ford guy, a guy who knows a lot about Chevys and talks a lot about Chevys, I'm still gonna put the Cummins 12 valve at the top of the list. That's it for this video. Stay tuned for more Cummins videos to come. If you like our content, please subscribe to our channel and give this video a like.